As director of Hamlin's Center for Global Environmental Education, Ferdin helps write multimedia teaching curriculums on Alabama's rivers and coasts.
But really, we're going to be telling it for the whole Gulf Coast, for the folks in that area, but then also it's a nationwide story, so we will be bringing it to a broader audience and showing that we're all connected. It's a global environment.
When we were in the swamps, there were men individually wiping off the plants, and it was just like, there's no way that they're going to be able to fix this problem.
I was addicted to shooting pictures at the National Geographic. We would routinely go off and shoot 10, 20, 30 rolls of film a day. Those are thousands of pictures a day. And then going back to the light table and being able to pick out the very best nuance of slightly different exposure, slightly different composition. And I think in the strictest sense of the Zen approach, less is more. I think you can focus with a very sharp, keen instrument, cut through all the extraneous material and go right to the essence when you're forced to make one picture.
Jim Vanderpool is one of a growing number of farmers who are moving toward more sustainable farming practices.
A sustainable farm would be one that sustains the soil in a condition where it can continue to produce without being damaged. In other words, we're not spending it, we're using it.
The Face of the Water in Time became a wonderful book. A book that was a dead language to the uneducated passenger, which told me its mind without reserve, delivering its most cherished secrets clearly, as if it had uttered them with a voice.
In Chauvin, Louisiana, shrimp fishing has long been a way of life. David Chauvin's family has been in the shrimping business for more than 100 years.
I'm fourth generation. My grandpa, my great-grandfather did it, my grandfather did this, and my father. If this industry was to go down, it would be devastating to this community.
So the forest birds likely came here on the wind, blown off course on the wind. And it was likely the ancestor to one of the main forest bird families here in Kauai was a rosy finch, like your house finch that you see around your houses anywhere in North America. And it just got blown off course in a big storm, arrived here and had these uninhabited islands to explore and explode into. And because there were so many different niches here in the Hawaiian Islands that weren't being occupied by anything else, that one species turned into 50 different species, more than 50 different species of honeycreeper, with all sorts of different beak types and colors and sizes that filled all these different niches. So some of them picked fruit, and some of them ate insects, and some of them ate seeds. Some of them do what woodpeckers do on the mainland. And they just exploded. That's what we call an adaptive radiation.
Hi, Connie.
Hey, hi.
Nice to meet you. How you doing?
Good. How are you?
Great. I'm glad you could be here.
So where exactly does the water come from up here?
60% of the water that feeds both Lake Itasca behind you and the Mississippi River behind me is water that's seeping up through springs in the lake bed and the river bed. So only 40% is that heavy rainwater or snowmelt that comes in off the surface of the land. And even in the middle of winter, when it is 60 below zero, the water continues to flow. So this truly is the beginning of the Mississippi.